So, ray tracing. In one weekend, I tried to do it in one evening, I got to a flat circle. But I believe most of the work is done and we could move to 3D in no time. First, let's delete this printing camera. We know that camera works at least okay for this circle. And let's open our sphere code that we debugged so long last time. Hold sphere. We have this T parameter here, and it basically defines like if we remember our equations, where how far from the origin of the ray is a point where ray hits a sphere. So having this T, we could calculate that point where ray hit a sphere. It would be ray at like point on a ray at the distance T from origin. Let's add such a method to ray. Distance float 64, and it will return a vector, and that vector would be ray origin plus direction scale by distance. But now here we could make a direction unit vector right now, or agree that direction will be unit vector when we create array. Let's check a camera code. See, yeah, it's probably not guaranteed to be a unit vector, but we could make it. Now, does it work? It does not, because camera broke now. Why? Online, we have not declared something in P. Compare camera test 19. So line 19 here. We subtract. Yeah, direction should point up, but it no longer will be of the length of 2. It will be length of 1. Test pass. Now Go is telling us we need to do something with this point. And what could we do? We could compute normal at hit point. And normal would be basically just difference vector that points from the center of the sphere through the hit point. So that would be point subtract sphere center. And it, normal usually useful to also have with the length of 1. Why? Because when you compute lighting, for light that shines, for example, from the top, so that would be 0, 1, 0. If you compute a dot product of light direction with normal, let's do that, and dot with this, it will dot product is product of vector lengths and cosinus of angle between them, and if they both have lengths of 1, it's basically cosinus of angle between them. And let's call this shade. Why? Because if cosinus is 1, like it's the maximum illumination. If cosinus is 0, angle is like 90 degrees and rays don't hit the surface of the sphere, they just touch it and slide near it, and if it's negative angle is more than 90 degrees, and that means that light shines from other direction. So let's use a shade here. Maybe let's make it, I don't know. Yeah, we have this cosinus, and let's convert it to wind 8. I don't know, make it 50 plus 200, multiply it by that. So it will be from 50 to 250. Ah, wait. It could be negative, yeah. Let's if shade less than 0, make it 0. Oh, we should have a min function. Don't know yet. So we have this shade of what? 0.8 shade multiplied by 200. And let's make everything. Yeah, let's make it like this. And see what we have here. Now it's green everywhere and a little bit illuminated from the top with a red light. Yeah, let's make it not so green. Ta-da! Now we have a sphere with the red light that shines from the top of the sphere. We could play with other stuff, like, I don't know, add to more, like move it further. So we could see more stuff. Add another sphere above this one, and add another one below. Ta-da! We have three spheres. Let's, for the sake of testing our camera, add another object, a plane. But since I'm already tired with doing too much mass, let's make a plane axis aligned. That would mean it could be either horizontal, frontal, or sagittal. Sagittal. Sagittal basically means frontal would be plane that screen is in. Horizontal means like surface of the sea, for example, and sagittal is the plane basically that splits your head in two through the line of nose. And yeah, we will define here some constant, like world. In world we will define what horizontal means, and since we know that it's horizontal, it will have only one coordinate, would be 8 for this case. For example, let's make it minus 2.0, split that lower sphere in 2. And world up, go. How do we design a hittable object? The same way as we designed another hittable object, basically a sphere. But instead, we will rename it from sphere to plane, and it will have orientation and one coordinate. Yeah, that's a good thing about axis aligned objects. They have less coordinates and less parameters in equation. In equations. So, how do you know if you should return hit result or not? Does the ray hit a plane? And here we have one coordinate, it's y. So y equals coordinate. And for the ray, that equals ray origin y plus direction y multiplied by some t we should find the value of. So let's let's decrease left and right side of equation by this. That would be 8 minus this equals this. And now what's left to do is divide all both sides of equation by this. So basically may put this in parentheses, divide by this, and it equals t. Yeah, but to make it work we write t equals this thing here. But we should check division by zero. What means if our ray direction by y is zero? It means that ray will not be able to hit horizontal plane because it will never cross it. But since we have we need to define what is horizontal. So const horizontal equals iota, and another plane is frontal and sagittal, something like that. Anyway, and here we switch by orientation. Orientation is horizontal. Ta-dam. But we want t be in outer scope. Like this. So t. Now we want t to be more than zero, because if it's less than zero, like rays don't travel in both directions, they have only one direction. And now if t is more than zero, we hit the plane. Ta-dam! Let's make a plane green. We don't have shade yet. Let's see. Non-bool r direction y. If r direction y is zero, then ta-da, we have plane that cut this bottom sphere in half, but it looks very boring. And it will not be helped with normals and shading, because like it has the same normal pointing up. We could add texture. I will not load image for it, but we could create some procedural texture. For that we need UV coordinates, and for horizontal plane it's plain simple. So U would be, first we need a point where plane hit a sphere, ray hit a plane. Damn. Maybe it's too late for me to explain my programming. But at least I not cough as much as last time. So ray at distance 10. And we just select x and y coordinate, right? Point x, that would be u, and v would be point z, not y. Y goes perpendicular to our plane. It should also be inside such a case. Later, maybe we definitely we will write code for all the other planes, because if we are not planning to use it, why code this? But I want them to be positive. And I want them to repeat. We have such a function called mod, which given, for example, 1, will round this to closest integer, because I want once and like find biggest integer less than this value and then subtract that integer from this value. That would be modulo or remainder of division, but it's for floats. So now u would be from 0 to 1, the same would be b. But it's not the case for horizontal. Yeah, let's make it like this. Var u v float 64. Now px pz. So this is what's specific for the orientation. Now we just make it u equals mass mod mass apps u 1.0 and same for b. And now we will change color depending on that. So color by default would be this. But if u less than more than 0.1 and v more than 0.1, we will make another color. Make it gray. I believe that would give us a grid. Ta-da! And now we could see like dimensions and axes. We know that one square here has a side of 1, so we could see this sphere has a radius of 1, and we could see that our camera is along of some horizontal axis. Maybe that it's that, because we decided that it would be that, but maybe it's x. We could rotate the camera, for example, we rotated p divided by 2, but we could rotate 45 degrees, ta-da, or we could rotate it, I don't know, p divided by 2 plus 0.1, ta-da, a little bit to the side, or completely zero. But it would be the same view but without spheres. Why we are missing line here? Pure luck, I would say. You see, it's always pixel is only totally green or totally gray. There is no half tones. Why? Because we sent only one race in pixel. We could send more, but it would be basically the same as increasing the number of pixels here and then averaging them. That would make anti-aliasing for us. Let's center spheres again. I don't like this. skew. Yep, perfectly aligned. You see, we increased resolution of our picture, and now we have more horizontal lines, like less horizontal lines missing. But still, like when we approach infinity, it's just noise. And here we have crazy aliasing, a little bit covered by JPEG artifacts. Maybe we should convert, like encode in PNG, don't know. But looks already a little bit 3D. But to make it interesting, let's make sphere reflective. Let's keep one sphere for now. How to reflect light? Well, first we want to have, okay, camera is okay, yes, everything works, no, not everything works fine, geometry fails, in sphere test. No, geometry is okay, cached. What fails is world sphere test go. Why? It fails on line 23 because it wanted 2 and got 1. Hit distance. Yeah, we agreed for Ace to have like unit directions, but here I have wrong race. That's what. So we know where ray hits sphere. And for reflection, I will not bore you with formal switch. Reflected ray will start at this point, obviously, and its direction would be, let's call it RD, reflected direction. It would be direction of incoming ray plus, I will write it first like in C++, if, like if we had operator overload and then convert to our methods. Plus normal, but scaled. And scale, I'll told I will convert later. So normal multiplied by minus 2. And then dot product between R direction and normal. Why dot product? Because that would mean we project our incoming ray to normal, and then if like make it, I saw an illustration somewhere. Reflection. Yeah, here. So if we compute we have this ray, it's incoming ray direction, we want this ray. We want normal to be this length, and this length basically is a projection of this vector to the normal. And that is their dot product. So basically this formula, and we convert it in Go. So plus would be add, and then normal scalar multiplication would be scaled to this thing, and minus 2 multiplied by R direction and dot. That is reflected direction. Let's discard shade. Like we don't need it. Okay, reflect the direction and hit result. We want reflected ray in hit result. We call it ray. Ah, but we want pointer. Not all the objects in our world will reflect. Some of them just consume the ray and return color. And here we write reflected is ray that starts in origin would be P and direction would be direction reflected direction and that's pointer. Now with the world. So imagine here we found a heat of some object. What do with that? If it reflects, we need to heat again, but we could not heat like infinitely because we are risking getting in infinite loop. So we should have some max reflections. Let's make it 10 for now. Now we write for ref equals 0, ref less than max reflections, ref plus plus. We all do this heating at least 10 times if we are affected. But here, if closest, like closest hit that we found, reflected equals nil, we not reflect anywhere, we just break from this loop. Now it's not nil, right? We have ray. We will go in a loop again, but this time ray would be oldest reflected and it's a pointer. I forgot the name of this operator. Let's test this. Scaled. Sphere goes around to 3. Maybe it should be called scaled. Defined shade. Sphere goes around to 5. Let's make our sphere. I'm running tasks, but I see tests not always cover everything. We have when we use pointers, we always have something. Nil pointer, the reference. That's a risk you should take. World on line 45. Here. What if closest is nil? So if closest is nil here, we not hit anything and no reflection. Turn nil. And here we break and then return closest, which is nil. Could write if closest equals nil or basically the same. Closest bam. Is it correct? Hard to say. looks interesting. First, why? Like, could we make sphere do not have its own color and be 100% mirror? Why it still sorry, why it still has a color? Ah, because if the ray that we reflected does not hit anything here, we will not assign new value for closest, but we should make it closest here, nil again, start search from the beginning. Ta-da! Now it's looking insanely weird. Like, seems like soft bubble. Like at the bottom half of the picture it should be completely black, because once ray hits here it should be reflected up, and let's so basically here we complete a number of hits, by the way. Do we need it? No, I should delete it. So if hit is not nil, let's print array that that was causing this, and return. Yeah, stop right there. Boom. So first ray that hit something is minus something by x. Okay, it's a little bit here, minus 0 0 0 by y, but it's already lower part of the picture. By the way, also going by columns, not by, we're going like that. What we should call like that. I'll just switch these two loops. Should go give us another ray. Now we have a little bit more centered by x thingy, and y is about zero, so it's upper part of the picture, but we should not hit anything. So let's take this vector and create a plane. Is okay, sphere world. Let's create let's create a world test. I like split, by the way. When I write tests, look at the code that I'm testing. So we take this world, for example. Func test with plane and here t test pointer. We have a world, we have misbehaving ray that we should wait, it's not the whole ray, but basically origin is zero and it's zero by default. Yes, array would be array direction only, interesting. Think the array missing comma before new line, copy that one. Yeah, that's a common mistake I do. And also missing some imports like geometry and world. Yeah, let's close this image. It's not a string sync, it doesn't have a single pixel set. So in test we not defined world because we inside the package world. Why do we need to define it? We don't. Yeah, we built, we initialized stuff here, but we don't test anything. So what we say is if world is hit with this array, in this case we want hit to miss, like. There is nothing about here you call it T. Ta-da. And test fails because we expected nil but got this thingy. And we have problem in this hit. We could look what it hits. Hit is nil continue, else so ray hits object. Whoa, wait. I forgot a new line. A lot of reflections. Ray hits sphere, then it hits sphere again and hits sphere. Like we have one sphere. So it hits sphere, yeah, and it has this origin, then it has the same origin and the same origin. Ray is not moving but constantly hitting a sphere. I think it's trapped. So basically if T is zero we are hitting a sphere, right? But we should not, because we just reflected from it. Let's make T, like if T is less than 0, 0, 0, 1 or something, then it doesn't hit a sphere. So we have less hits. Ta-da! No, now it does not hit a sphere. Let's see what image that gives us. Too much output. We want output to be done in pixels, not in text. Too little output. I want more pixels, not just zero. Wow. That's that looks nice, like a smile. What if we rise the sphere a little bit up? 1.0. Oh. Looks interesting. But sphere is like completely invisible. I think we should also, I don't know, for the parts where it reflects into nothing, we return color, you see here. We should mix it with the color of the world. How? Or maybe we should not. I have another idea in mind, but that's probably be a topic for another video. And here we could finish with reflective sphere and infinite plane. Looks already a little bit more 3D than just a red circle, right?